The wonderful Zoom entrance. We've all gotten used to it. You have to imagine us walking out onto the stage or whatever magical entrance you can imagine, as opposed to just turning on the camera. But here I am, Max Owre, Executive Director of Carolina Public Humanities, doing what is to me the most fun part of my job, which is this series we started in the spring, Lunch with Friends and Strangers. It's just such a delight to be able to talk to smart people about really interesting people who often were very smart as well. I want to, before we introduce our friend and introduce our stranger, I want to, of course, thank Paul Bonici for doing a lot of this work for us behind the scenes and the wonderful way he set up all of these events for us. He is our access point to the outside world, so we're very thankful to Paul and, of course, to all of our friends at Carolina Public Humanities who are doing great work, making sure that we're still reaching the public as we're doing. I also want to thank some sponsors, the Cotton Mercury Group and Morgan Stanley, being a wonderful partner of ours throughout the our especially in this time, but even before, of course, supporting our K-12 programs. And Carolina Meadows, a wonderful partner of ours who have been supporting our public programming and have recently come on to sponsor our K-12 programming as well. We love our partner Flyleaf Books for their great help that they've been doing. We encourage everybody to go to Flyleaf Books for their shopping needs this Christmas. We hope people are buying books for each other still. And also a very special partner, the General Alumni Association of UNC, which is partnering in particular on this project, but also making sure that we're reaching people in the outside world. So if any of you have gotten to us through the General Alumni Association, we're so thankful, and we hope to be doing more partnerships with them in the future. I will mention a few upcoming programs at the end of this, but we've been talking too long without getting to the really important point. So I want to introduce our friend first. Our friend is Dr. Beverly Taylor, who is walking onto the stage right now in the form of turning on the camera. So this is, and we'll unmute your microphone as well and say welcome to Beverly Taylor.
Thank you, Paul. Max, I'm so pleased to be with you all today.
It's a delight to have you. And for those that don't, we'll put some information on Beverly Taylor down here in the chat. But Beverly is an expert on Victorian literature, former chair of the English department. I know that that's probably good to have that behind you right now. It's a lot of work, and I could only imagine what that's like now. But in all of that, expert on Victorian literature, have written extensively on Tennyson, on Charlotte Bronte, and I could just keep naming. I know that you came and gave a great public humanities program on The Great Gatsby for us at one point. So a wide range of expertise, but certainly someone near and dear to Beverly Taylor's heart is Elizabeth Barrett Browning, who is our stranger today. And I'm just gonna quickly remind folks who Elizabeth Barrett Browning is, in case you don't know, we're going to pull up a quick picture here. And the funny thing about pictures, of course, is not everybody knows Elizabeth Barrett Browning through pictures at all. But for the sake of having something to look at, here is a picture of our stranger, Elizabeth Barrett Browning. And before we even get into Elizabeth, can you tell us a little bit about this picture?
Yes, this was a rare photograph. I think it was the first photograph she ever had made in 1858, I believe, when they were holidaying in France. She had this made because she had decided to include a frontispiece in the next edition of her great epic length poem, Aurora Leigh, which is a novel written in blank verse. Mm-hmm. And she had never wanted to release an image of herself to the general reading public because she wanted people, she hid mostly. She was used to staying in an invalid sick room alone and not meeting people from the outside world, though she held up a lively correspondence with many people. But people had written and asked her for photographs or paintings, and she always said she didn't have one until this one she had made to include, because there'd been bogus representations of her.
I think I have a few of those that I've looked, because I was looking for them, as we mentioned, when preparing for this. And you're right, it's not easy to find images of Elizabeth Barrett Browning. By the way, I just want to ask an aside. I find her incredible. I find the eyes to be absolutely penetrating and a beautiful person, really quite attractive, actually. Was that a sense? I mean, that's not important, of course, for understanding the, we're going to get into the work and whatnot, but she was not, was she not proud of her image, or just was sort of cloistered and didn't feel like it was important?
Well, I think she didn't think the way she looked was important. And she did want to sort of hide away from the world. She was very shy. But I don't think anybody ever said she was really attractive looking, but they found her mesmerizing when they talked to her. They loved her voice. They loved her eyes. I think it's interesting that you focused on that, the eyes.
And they're penetrating. We of course can only make, you know, sort of surface judgments here, right? You know, but certainly it's an intense picture. It's not a picture just sort of, you know, a flat person. This is a picture that reaches out and grabs you, I think, with that intensity. And I think it is in the eyes. Let's, you know, thinking a little bit about Elizabeth Barrett Browning broadly, we're talking about very sort of, you know, her traits as a person at that particular moment in time. And as I just mentioned to you, I had a hard time finding pictures. So how is it that we think about Elizabeth Barrett Browning today as a broad sweep? You had to situate her in the canon of English literature or in the canon of English poetry. Where does she fall?
Well, that's a very interesting question, because until the late 1970s, she would have fallen where, when I was in graduate school, I had a professor who handed out a Xerox sheet, a mimeograph sheet of the secondary poets of the age we needed to know something about, but we never needed to read. And he put her on that, which is not where she would stand today, where she is recognized as the first important woman poet in the English language. She is recognized as one of the top three Victorian poets, along with Tennyson, who became poet laureate, and her husband, Robert Browning, who didn't become famous until after she had died. He was nowhere on the literary map when she was quite a famous writer in her lifetime. So now I think we understand, we read a much larger canon of her work than was read even in 1970. When she was known mostly for her series of sonnets from the Portuguese, which explored the romance developing between her and Robert Browning. And that's what people knew her as, the adoring wife of a much greater poet.
How do I love thee, right? This is, it's the first, it's a poem everybody can cite the first line. Or line or two, and they might know it's Elizabeth Barrett Browning, and that seemed to be where she was until people resurrected a lot of this other important work. Let's get a little bit into the biography so what can you tell us about Elizabeth Barrett Browning's upbringing, what type of family she was born into? And
she grew up in a very large, very rich family. They had multiple sugar plantations on Jamaica, worked by slave labor. Wow. And so back in England, where her father had been sent for school and then stayed on to live, they were fabulously wealthy, and he built a home for them. I think their estate was over 400 acres in the south of England, and it was bucolic, beautiful. He built a mansion in a kind of, what do they call it? Gothic Indian style, with towers and minarets. And it had subterranean passageways, so you could walk to the barn and not have to get out in the rain. It was amazing. It had inlaid ivory in the doors. Wow. It was an astonishing place, but he lost that. He had to sell it because of a lawsuit that went against him, where some mixed race members of the family were suing for a portion of their financial rights. Wow. And he lost that case and ended up having to sell Hope Inn, that great estate. And they moved into London, into a townhouse in London.
So she was born in 1806, of 11 children, did you say, or?
Yeah.
And where was she on that?
Was the eldest. She was the eldest, and she was viewed as a literary genius by her parents, because she began writing poetry when she was so young. The earliest poem we have by her, she didn't write, but she composed it, and her mother wrote it down. It's 4 lines on naval impressment. What were you thinking about when you were 6 years old?
Well, full confession, I was already immersed in Horatio Hornblower, so I might have already read a little bit about impressment. It was some of the first novels I ever read, maybe 6, maybe, but by 8 years old, I knew what naval impressment was, but I certainly wasn't writing poems about it at a young age. Did she have a relationship that was sustained with her mother and father through her upbringing? It sounds like they were encouraging learning, which is not always the case.
And they encouraged her writing. So her mother played the role of her publisher. We have little notes that pass back and forth between them when young EBB would write, "I hope you'll produce this poem," and under our same terms. So she seems to be being paid by her mother, who produced these poems. And her father wrote her a note addressed to the poet laureate of Hope End, which was the name of their estate. He misspelled laureate, by the way, but we can
well, spelling doesn't really become a convention for a while, so.
That's right.
So interesting, you know, this is not, she's not raised in a vacuum. This is, of course, when I think of 1806 and I think around that, I think of Jane Austen, I think of female writers. So was that an influence or a way of looking at opportunity there for writing for Elizabeth Barrett Browning?
I don't think they were viewing it, not her parents were not viewing it as a professional outlet for her. Nobody was thinking in those terms for women at that time. So they thought it was cute. She was precocious and they were going to encourage that. Mm-hmm. But as she grew older, her father was very much against, her father got peculiar, I have to say. And he didn't want her to publish poems under her name. The best she could do, he said, was publish under her initials. But mostly he wanted her work published, if it had to appear in public, published anonymously. So he didn't consider it appropriate for a grown woman. But one thing he did that was so important for her, when she was a young girl, he allowed her to study Greek along with her brother, who had a tutor who had been brought into the home to prepare him for going off to school. But when she was 11, her brother was sent to boarding school, and suddenly all her lessons stopped. Wow. So she was entirely self-educated from the age of 11 on. She read everything. She learned every foreign language. She was amazing. Well, I shouldn't say that. She didn't learn Chinese, but she read Greek with great facility at a time when the classical languages were viewed as the province of men.
Sure. That was part of the classical education, Greek and Latin. And so continues to write, obviously. When is she first published?
Well, her first publication was privately paid for by her father, or her aunt actually paid the money. She had written, it was in the style of an epic, a poem about the Battle of Marathon.
Oh, wow.
Books long. Yeah, so we have that. So she did publish it privately, but it was out there.
And what year would that have been around?
That would have been 1817.
Wow. So 11 years old?
Mm-hmm.
Wow. What's really interesting about that topic, the Battle of Marathon, is that, you know, this is an age where we're going from sort of neoclassicism to romanticism. And that's a very classical type of topic. It's it's very interesting. So, and yet at the same time, she becomes, you know, somewhat romantic. Where does she fit in that sort of large, I know I'm using very general terms about these schools of thought, but where does she fit in there? And how does that sort of, that tension between classic ideas and romantic sentiment emerge in her early work?
Well, I think people living in those times didn't realize they had to choose an affiliation. Mm-hmm. So you're right. She was molded by her classical reading and neoclassical thought of the period, but she's also very much influenced by the romantic writers of her day. She thought, she called Wordsworth a king poet, wrote about him and about Shelley and Byron. She became very much interested in the passionate intensity of romanticism. So, and she was not limited to being influenced by English writers, of course, because she read widely in continental literature.
Was she reading Victor Hugo and sort of French romantics?
Yes, and then she went on to be very much enthusiastic about George Sand, who was quite a scandal in her own day. Mm-hmm. George Sand, you know, is the French novelist who wore men's trousers and smoked cigars in public and took a male pseudonym to publish under. So Elizabeth Barrett Browning, who I think was very feminine in her own way, was excited by that. Mm. She actually, one of her early really popular poems was a ballad that she wrote about a woman who crossed dresses to go onto the battlefield to serve her husband. It's kind of a complicated story. I don't know if you want all the details, but she had been married. The husband who married her didn't know her, didn't love her, was marrying to pay a debt of honor he owed to her father who died. So she then did this. He said he had to go before their wedding night. He had to go off and fulfill a promise to go on the Crusades. So she dressed up as a page and went with him on the Crusades. And in the poem, we learn that she had saved his life three times, once in the tent and twice on the battlefield. So she was behaving in a very unfeminine way. But interestingly, BB had the sly way of undercutting conventions of the time. So she shows this woman who's doing exactly what a wife was supposed to do, serve her husband and take care of him. But she's doing it by dressing as a man and fighting. You know, so what were people supposed to make of that, her readers?
Wow, that's, and this is the publication date of that. Of that epic poem story? So I'm just a general sense, just trying to picture.
Yeah, that's in the early 1830s.
Okay.
So the romance of the page.
So she, during the 1820s, is establishing a record of publication.
Yes.
And in terms of her renown early on, who's reading and who's responding to her writing?
Well, that's a good question. I think early on, it was mostly women who were reading her. She published some in periodicals that were especially popular with women. The New Monthly Magazine, for example. And she contributed to some of the gift books, the annuals that were sold for the Christmas trade that were mostly prized for their pictures, their etchings, for example, their representations of famous paintings. And then people would be commissioned to write poems or stories that would go along with, that would illustrate those illustrations. But the literature wasn't considered important. But in every one of those contributions EBB made to the gift books, she did something radical, something different, something challenging, like having her heroine dress as a man and still be the heroine.
Yeah. So she, you mentioned a lot of things are published anonymously, but she's also publishing as Elizabeth Barrett, I assume, at this point, or E.B.
E.B.B. Her name was actually Elizabeth Barrett, Elizabeth Barrett Moulton Barrett.
Okay.
So She published as Elizabeth Barrett Barrett. So
oh, okay, I was confused by it because you were saying EBB, but I haven't gotten to this point. Now I know one of the things you've done, you know, great work on the wide sweep of her literature, but right now you're particularly immersed in a project about a particular era in her life. And of course, many people know Elizabeth Barrett, not as Elizabeth Barrett Barrett, but as Elizabeth Barrett Browning. So we need to introduce this person and get a sense about Robert Browning and how they met. And, you know, what can you tell us about where this fits in the trajectory of her life? She's already writing. She's already being read.
She's just become famous. In 1844, she published a 2-volume collection of her poems, both in America and in England, and it was a big hit. And one of the poems she included in that collection was Lady Geraldine's Courtship, which again is sort of innovative and radical in the sense that she has a woman character who falls in love with a lower born poet. She invites him to a house party. They read poems out loud to each other and they fall in love over that. And she turns down a titled man who asks her to marry him because she wants to marry this low born poet. So, yeah, in the middle
of. Are you saying there's a subtext to this, Beverly?
Well, it is, because the life that she lived kind of played out the plot line of that poem she had written before she ever met Robert Browning. So he's reading along in this new poem and he finds a compliment to his poetry. She celebrates some of the modern poets that they're reading aloud to each other, the characters in her poem. And she refers to Robert Browning's series of poems that hardly anybody was reading. He was paying to have published a series of little paperback fascicles that he titled Bells and Pomegranates. So in her poem, she refers to Robert Browning, who, if you cut his poem into the heart of it, you would find something as blood red as a pomegranate. And anyway, it was just a lovely metaphor and a lovely compliment to him. And he was listed there with up and coming poets of the day like Tennyson. And he was blown away. So he wrote her a piece of fan mail. My dear Miss Barrett, I do love your verses with all my heart, he said. And he went on within a couple of sentences to say, and I love you too.
Oh, had they met?
No.
So it's just completely in love with the idea and the ideas of Elizabeth Barrett Barrett at this point.
Yes. And so he talked about the fact that her imagery was so profound and so innovative, and he was deeply moved by the rhythms of her poetry. So he went on to celebrate what he loved about her poetry, and he asked if he could come and visit. And she said, oh, no, I never see anybody outside my own family. And he kept persisting, maybe in the spring when the weather's bad, I can come. And he just kept writing and kept asking to come and see her.
So to be clear, is she still living with her parents at this point?
Well, her mother died when she was around 20, 21. Okay. That was a great blow. All of the adult siblings, so now there are 11 of them, there's still 9 living at this point. And they're living with their father in a townhouse in London at 50 Wimpole Street. So, you know, the general story, probably the Barretts of Wimpole Street, about her running away with Robert Browning, but that's not exactly how it happened. But the oddity, her father had gotten really quirky and he had become totally opposed to any of his children marrying, which is weird because he himself had 12 children, 11 lived to adulthood.
He's not going to be able to care for them all. I mean, it's isn't marriage the way that you secure the financial you know, the security of your children is often in that era and among that class is through marriage.
Yeah, but he just decided none of them should marry.
Not so that Robert Browning would have been a good choice, but you know, for securing your livelihood. So how do they end up together?
So finally, she agreed that he could come and visit. He started visiting regularly. And so we have a record of over 90 visits he paid to her in her invalid sick room. And I should back up and say she was a very famous invalid at this time.
What was she suffering from?
Well, they don't really know. It was some sort of a lung affliction. Though I don't think she had tuberculosis because they recognized tuberculosis at that time. Yeah. It was it was like the plague of the 19th century.
Sure, yeah.
Every big family had somebody with TB.
You can't have 19th century literature without tuberculosis.
That's right. So, but she had a lung affliction. She talked about feeling like she was breathing in glass.
Ooh.
She did have hemorrhages, so she would cough up blood. She couldn't eat. She couldn't, she had lots of problems. She was seriously ill.
Did this persist through her life, this infirmity?
Yes, it did. And it's finally what killed her. Mm. She died. Her lungs stopped working and she died.
Well, let's get to the point that because I know you're very interested in the honeymoon. And you're very interested in, and I'm just curious about what it is about the honeymoon that is worthy of us sort of paying extra attention to.
Well, so Robert Browning is paying her all these calls and visits, and they start writing to each other what's called the courtship correspondence. They're writing sometimes 2 and 3 times a day to each other. And what I find so remarkable about the penny post had just come in, and they were getting mail delivered to their homes 2 and 3 times a day. So at 8 o'clock at night, she's getting a letter from him. So they are falling in love rapidly. So
was
they
she responding with letters as well?
Oh yes, 2 and 3 times a day. Wow. And her letters are much more fascinating than his, I have to say, because she wrote long, detailed, beautiful letters. And his tended to be much shorter and sort of used complicated language. So it's a little difficult to sort them out. But anyway, so they correspond. He finally gets to come and visit. They're meeting 2, sometimes 3 times a week and having long private conversations in her sick room. I mean, it's a bed sitting room, so she's not lying in bed, but she's usually reclining on the sofa and he's sitting on his armchair talking to her. And her father knows he's visiting because her siblings make jokes about this Mr. Browning, the poet, who's coming to visit. But seriously, nobody was reading Robert Browning at this time. She's already so famous that I mentioned to you the other day, she could get a letter with no address on it, addressed to Elizabeth Barrett, poet, London. And she received that letter. That's how famous she was. So eventually Robert prevailed. Well, they had an idea that she needed to go to Italy for the warmer weather to help her lung affliction. But her father was so opposed to that. He wanted her to stay right there in the sick room and be an invalid for the rest of her days because she was dependent upon her dad and he liked that, I think.
Yeah, that's an, I mean, we can't really get into the psychology of the father, but I assume it must be, you know, we're losing the mother and for whatever reason, the sense of possessiveness about the kids is a sign of, you know, it's a sign of love, but it's also claustrophobic, right? So they get away. They do marry.
They marry secretly. So they plan to meet at a local church in her neighborhood. They get married and then they each go home to their parents' houses. And I should point out that she's 40 years old at this point and independent, financially independent. Thanks to bequests from her uncle and her grandmother, she could pay for her own living.
Was her writing bringing in any income and revenue?
Yes, but I think it was negligible. And then Robert is 34, so he's 6 years younger, an aspiring poet who is not famous, who's making no money whatsoever. In fact, he's paying to publish his own poems. And he's still living with his parents, very close to his mother. He sleeps with the door ajar between their rooms.
Dad, I brought home a 34-year-old who's living with his parents and self-publishing his poems.
So, and has no income. Right.
But they get married. And you describe in our preliminary discussions a honeymoon. How does that work?
Well, so they had determined that they would move to the continent, live in Italy, because Robert Browning felt sure that the warmer weather would improve her health. And that did work out. And I think it's fortunate because he had no medical knowledge. If he had walked into her sick room and said, "This is killing you, we need to get you to the sunny south," what if she had died on the crossing of the channel?
Yeah,
he never would have recovered.
No,
but
sure.
It worked out. He was they right.
They made it to Italy. I love this little piece here. We assume this was done around that. When was this? Was says 1853. So this is what year was the marriage?
1846.
So this is after. This is considerably later. Yes. But did they stay in Italy?
They did. They did eventually made some annual trips back to England. But her father would not receive them. Her father cut them as though his eldest daughter had died. And he cut her out of the will and he never spoke to her again. He never read her letters. She would write letters apologizing for her offense. And he'd never even opened them. So at one point he returned the whole packet of letters to her unopened.
That is just heartbreaking.
It was awful. She said his leaving life when he died in 1857, she said that it was like his banging the door behind him when he went out, that he would never speak to her before his death. So she never got over it.
So what can you tell me about the honeymoon? What is a honeymoon like for these two? And why are you fascinated in this particular aspect of their lives, or her life in particular?
Well, I think how hard it would have been for her to leave her family that she had lived with her whole life. She's age 40, never thought she could have an adult marriage because her health was so frail. She thought she would die if she moved out, but she still dared to marry Robert Browning. And they, after their marriage, they both went home to their parents' homes and stayed for another week before they met at the train station, went to the coast and took their voyage across the channel, and that was it. So travel was hard then. And she wrote about being banged up in the diligence they're traveling in, being so bruised, and she was so frail and fragile. She had to practice going outdoors before they met and married. I mean, met at the church to marry, because she had no stamina. She would stay in her sitting room, totter to the sofa, totter back to the bed. That was it. That was her life.
Well, and then imagine a trip to Italy is a daunting prospect.
Very huge. So I started looking into honeymoon trips in the 19th century and discovered that the honeymoon was sort of invented as an institution in the 19th century. The Victorians made this a part of the wedding industry, and it became a big business, weddings. And so they made postcards and mementos for honeymooners to buy, and you know, the whole travel industry grew up around this. So, but most of the accounts of Victorian honeymoons are about very negative experiences, because we have this idea that Victorians were so repressed sexually that they would have been horrified on the wedding night and not known what to do and had a terrible experience. And a lot of people do write about their honeymoon experiences in that way. But if you look at Victorian fiction, all of the accounts, virtually all the accounts of Victorian honeymoons are disasters.
Wow.
And yet the Brownings, EBB, wrote letters back to her sisters about the honeymoon period, ecstatically happy.
Was this period of happiness that seems, you know, again, so many things have changed in this person's life from going from this cloistered existence with a father, kind of sounds a little domineering father, to a, you know, free experience in love with a man going to Italy. Does this have an impact on her work and in a very noticeable way?
Absolutely. So one of the things that I've been interested in about her honeymoon is that she wrote a poem apparently on their honeymoon, maybe in the carriage, because it's a messy manuscript. It's really hard to read. But it's a poem in which she talks about their coming to Vaucluse, which was the home famous for Petrarch, sure, expressing his love for his beloved Laura.
Sure.
So they travel to Vaucluse, and she writes a poem about it that's never published, that horribly messy fragment in a manuscript, but she doesn't describe herself in terms of hearts and flowers the way ladies might have written about their honeymoon love. Instead, she writes about the landscape being so terrifying and so harsh, so barren. And she started off with an opening paragraph a verse that talks about standing in on her feet amidst the flowers, and she just abandons that entirely and goes on to write about the rocky, mountainous landscape, the violent fountain of Vaucluse, and she talks about those mountains as being like, like gladiators who strip bare except for a sneer upon their lips to go into the arena and fight with a sword.
Wow. I mean,
it's so harsh. It's so masculine, the way she's thinking of it. But you get the impression that she is considering herself as being rather like a gladiator who's daring, who's defying this whole family that's against her marriage. And she is moving into that new world. So it's not about sex, though the nakedness of the gladiators might invite us to think about that, but it's about confrontation and a self-assertion. And I just love that. So when she gets to Italy, her poetry explodes with an outward turning to embrace the world. She starts writing about Italian politics, the movement for Italian unification and independence.
Was she there in 1848?
Yes.
So,
they go in September 1846. She's very supportive of the Risorgimento. She writes a poem on her first anniversary. They are having a celebration in Florence of the fact that the Austrian appointed Duke who is ruling Florence as a city-state has allowed some freedom of the press and has allowed the people to form a civic guard. So she, like the Italians, is very excited that this might promise some independence down the road, but that Archduke goes back on his promises and is clearly a puppet of the Austrian Empire that's dominating Florence. And so she writes against that. She's very outspoken. But this is not new. She had written about public policy before she went to Italy, but now it just takes over her poetry and she's not writing about personal experience anymore. So she's not writing as a poetess. Mm. She's being a poet. She's being a poetic gladiator in a way.
Is this when, so after this transformation, is this when she begins to write on things like child labor in factories and was she, had she already addressed those topics before she left?
Yeah, and actually just a few years before her marriage, a couple of years before they started corresponding, she was writing about child labor in factories and mines. So she had become kind of politicized. And to be frank, this is the EBB I love. And when I teach her, you know, because the students think, oh, Elizabeth Barrett Browning loves her husband and that's why she writes sonnets to him. But they get galvanized when they start reading her other poetry against the oppression of children in factories. She has a wonderful abolitionist poem. She was invited to contribute to an abolitionist publication.
Did she think about her family history when she thought about abolitionism?
Yes, and she wrote to friends about, she frankly acknowledged that she would so much rather align with the abolitionists than with the source of her wealth. She was very outspoken about her grandfather who used to flog his slaves like a dictator or something. And she was a great supporter of freedom for individuals.
I assume, you know, it sounds to me it's not absolutely not necessary to have children make you care about children, but she does eventually have children. This is a picture of her with her son, Penn. Robert, is that, do I have the name correct?
His name was Robert Wiedemann Barrett Browning. So he was named to honor both grandparents.
Okay.
That's the Wiedemann was Robert's mother's maiden name. So I think it's so nice that you've chosen this image. This is a photograph they had made together in Rome just a year before she died, or actually less than a year before she died, a matter of months. So she's quite frail at this point, but she never imagined she would be strong enough to bear a child. So they gave almost no thought, the Brownings, to the possibility that she would get pregnant, but she seems to have gotten pregnant on that honeymoon.
And over the age of 40.
Yes. And so she had her son when she was about 43, I think.
Wow.
She had two serious miscarriages on either side of that successful pregnancy. She always hoped to have a daughter who could, she said, sit with her and in social events when the son would grow up and want to be with the men talking about sports and yachting and things like that. Hmm. She would like to have a daughter who would be by her side talking with her. But she adored that son. Mm-hmm. He became the center of her being once he was born.
And the two, Robert and Elizabeth, had a good, equitable relationship?
I think they did. I mean, her letters about their relationship are so exciting. At one point after the honeymoon, she wrote to her sister, "If you ever hear that Robert and I have argued, it will be, you know, it'll be a rarity, as if it had started snowing stars." I just love it.
That's...
So she does celebrate their they saw eye to eye on everything, except, and this is what biographers of Robert have made a big to-do of, the fact that they had three topics that they didn't agree on. And they've made this sort of a focal point of biographies that represent Robert as somebody who spent his life, expended his energies he should have devoted to his art, taking care of her. Oh. But that seems to have been the most important thing in his life.
And, gosh, that's funny. After the fact, we put these demands on these people who have already lived extraordinary enough lives themselves. Now, we're going to need to bring our little part of a conversation to a close so we can bring in some questions from folks here. She, of course, unfortunately, does not live as long as Robert Browning does. And what can we learn about her demise and impact and sort of immediate legacy? How did that affect the literary world at the time?
Well, that's an interesting point. She died in 1861, so she was only 55. And I don't think she or Robert expected her to die at that point. She had been sick, been frail. I mean, we can kind of see the handwriting on the wall looking back at her declining health in her last year and a half or so. But they were still quite shocked that they sent out for the doctor, and before he got there, she had died. There was an outpouring of, well, let me start. In Italy, where she was viewed as a kind of national heroine because she had supported their Risorgimento so aggressively, they closed all the shops on the street where she lived for her funeral. I mean, they put up a plaque on her house that she had forged a golden ring between England and Italy. So they recognized the importance of her passing. The reviewers in England were amazingly celebratory of some of her poetry, usually her earlier poetry. They didn't like the politics that she took up in her late years. And so they tended to lament, oh, if she had just remained that sweet Miss Barrett that we used to love, we would have been thrilled to talk about how great she was.
And just before I take the question, just to situate a few things, the Portuguese sonnets, the ones that many, you know, how do I love thee? Let me count the ways, etc. You know, that I have I think I even have an example here. Where do those fit in her life? Where and in terms of, are those the poems that people lamented and that they wanted more of that, as opposed to poems about, but so kind of situate some of her most well-known work in this biography.
Yeah, I think she wrote those poems during the courtship years from 1844 to 1846 when they married. And she mentioned them to Robert Browning, "Someday I'll show you what I've been working on, but not yet." And so it wasn't until they were happily married and living in Italy and his mother died and he was very depressed by that loss, Elizabeth presented him with the sonnets from the Portuguese manuscript, hoping it would cheer him up. And he was very opposed to publishing about personal life. That makes sense. We know him as a dramatic poet who lets other characters speak, and he doesn't speak out in his own voice. But he did feel that the sonnets from the Portuguese were so good that they had to be published, even though he was quite reluctant about it.
So of course the famous one here, which we won't do a recitation here, but I'm sure most people are familiar with "Let Me Count the Ways." And I love that you had mentioned that this is a real sort of utilitarian thinking, you were saying, goes into this, as well as this being a love poem. This is also a sort of commentary about the way people think about the human experience. Am I
absolutely
around the contours of this, at least?
Absolutely. So just think about the implications of wanting to count how you love somebody in a world that's dominated by utilitarian thinking, where we measure things and we weigh them and we count what's practical and what works to achieve the greatest good for the greatest number of people. And she just undercuts that entirely, I think, by starting out, "How do I love thee? Let me count the ways." And we think she's going to count the ways. And then she moves into abstractions. "The depth and breadth and height my soul can reach when feeling out of sight for the ends of being and ideal grace." I mean, so we are not weighing and counting and measuring.
Yeah, I love thee with the passion put to use in my old Greece with child. That is not something you put on a scale.
No. And you know, this poem has become so familiar to people. There's even I saw an advertisement for a glove maker that started off, "How do I glove thee? Let me count the ways."
I hope that 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 would be the way, easiest way to count that. And again, we're going to get right to questions, but I thought this was an interesting contrast. And yet from what I'm hearing, it's not really a contrast. When I look at this poem, "If Thou Must Love Me," in which I'm not going to recite it here for everyone, but in which, you know, she's basically saying, you know, don't you tell me all the things that you love me for, but love me for love's sake, that evermore thou mayst love on through love's eternity. So they really are of a piece, even though one seems to say, let me count the ways, but she's not. And this one is saying, you can't count the ways.
Yes, exactly. And that corresponds to a letter she had written to Robert. She said, I don't want you to love me for any particular reason. I just want you. And he had won her heart by saying, I just love you because I love you.
And that's
because she said,
if we could all be so lucky, right? Love is a beautiful thing. And you know what I love? I love questions. Beverly, I know like everything when we do this, we just scratch the surface. And it's so frustrating because I could do this for hours with you and learn more about it. But let's see what kind of questions we have from our audience. First of all, Ed Davis just says that he missed seeing you at JASP this summer and he hopes the program will take place this coming summer. We all do. The Jane Austen Summer Program is an absolutely wonderful asset and wonderful gift to the University of North Carolina. So we all hope that. But I'm going to now go to Ed's question. He said, did you say that Elizabeth was the first important English female English poet? Where does Emily Bronte fit in with the early female English poets? And again, your talk was very interesting and he will read up on EBB. So justify that claim.
Okay, so the people who were well known as poets, women poets, were typically in the early Victorian period categorized as poetesses because they were so feminine. They wrote pretty poems about pretty things. They wrote about hearts and flowers, and EBB didn't do that. She resisted the conventions. So Emily Bronte is actually writing probably about the same time she starts writing in her youth, but she wasn't known as a poet until after she had died. So I still think it's a fair claim to say that Elizabeth Barrett Browning was the first known important poet, woman poet of the day. Even though there are other people like Felicia Hemans was really famous in her time, and she was a generation before EBB, but she became a poetess. She started writing about, she was very familiar with affairs on the continent. She had brothers who fought in continental wars against Napoleon, for example, and she started writing about topics like that, and they were not well received because women were thought to inhabit a separate sphere, that they should be preoccupied with domesticity and affections. And that's what they should write about.
So just as an add-on to that question, with, you know, the great novel, of course, the Brontes are also novelists and Jane Austen. Where do they fit in with what is appropriate for women to write about?
Okay, so the three Bronte sisters all published first in 1847. And they used male pseudonyms because they said the pseudonyms they chose sound masculine to me, Currer, Ellis, and Acton Bell, but they're kind of weird names. And they said they didn't feel comfortable masquerading as males in the public sphere. So they chose pseudonyms that were sort of ambiguous in terms of sex. But I think clearly they're intending to be taken seriously as male writers. They said they chose pseudonyms to publish under because they didn't feel reviewers would give them the same serious attention if they were women writers. And that proves to be the case.
But in someone like Jane Austen, who's earlier, is just of a different era, and it was writing more in the domesticity, I suppose. And
She said her perfect topic was two country families in a small area, close neighborhood. And people used to complain that all of Jane Austen's six novels have the same plot that end with wedding bells, getting the girl married. Of course, that's not true. That's a very narrow understanding of Jane Austen's fiction. But she herself confessed that she never felt comfortable representing male characters. So in all of her six novels, you never see two men talking together without a woman present.
It's the reverse Bechdel, right? you know, the Bechdel test. Where, so it's in this guy, that's a really interesting. So
yeah, so she didn't presume to write things that she didn't know firsthand. But EBB just says, I am not going to be put in a feminine box, and I'm going to write about subject matter that's important.
Very, yeah, she's certainly remarkable. I have a question here from Susan Broncore. Hello, Susan. We miss you. I can picture you now asking this question. Were her personal expressions about the political and cultural situation published in Italian newspapers? And if so, how were they received by the Italian public? You did give us a sense about, you know, the mourning here, but I guess a little bit more detail. And were these writings published in England? So were people aware of what she was doing in Italy while she was, you know, were they aware of her Italian political writings, if you will?
Yes, and she sent those poems about Italy back to be published in England. And sometimes they were rejected. Sometimes they were criticized for being un-English, because she was critical of England's failure to support Italy in its movement for independence and nationhood. She was very outspoken about that. So she took a lot of heat from the English reviewers. Meanwhile, back in Italy, her work is circulating and it is being published in newspapers and magazines. And some of her work was translated into Italian by a famous Italian writer who was associated with the Risorgimento. So these things were known on both sides of the channel. And in Italy, they loved her for it. And in England, they were not so keen.
Great. Thank you for that. We're running up against the end of our time here. We have Jane. Hello, Jane. I can also picture this good friend of ours out there. Do you have a particular favorite among EBB's poems? That's probably like asking what your favorite child is, but
I can't say, but I do love a poem called The Romaunt of the Page, which she wrote early on when people were still looking to her to be a feminine poet, but she undercuts the idealization of the wife as the feminine ideal, because she has a protagonist there who dresses up as a man to go on the Crusades to the Holy Land to support her husband's fighting in the Crusades. And on the way back, they're heading back to England. And so she poses a kind of test for her husband to see how he's going to measure up. And she says, you know, I had a sister who dressed up as a page to go to the Holy Land to serve her husband. And he said, oh, that wouldn't do for my wife. She would need to stay home and pray in the church and be, you know, wee wifey supporting me. And at this point, the woman who's dressed as a page, she sees some Saracens pursuing them, and she turns back to face them because she would rather be dead then go back to England to be married to a husband who wants to put her in that feminine box. It's a great.
Well, that sounds like so. I would also stir, you know, you have put together, was it 2010 or 2012, where you put together the definitive collection of Elizabeth Barrett Browning's poems that includes some unpublished work and whatnot. So we steer everyone to that. And we also, of course, steer everyone to keep an eye on when Dr. Taylor's work on Victorian honeymoons and Elizabeth Barrett Browning will be out. And we turn all of you to please embrace reading poetry. It's one of the most, for me, meditative. And I know I'm sort of preaching to the crowd. Anybody who comes on a public humanities thing probably has done a fair amount of reading of poetry, but I can't stress enough just how much of a wonderful and therapeutic thing it is. And we're just blessed to have people like Elizabeth Barrett Browning to give us these little triggers of life. And for people like Dr. Beverly Taylor for helping us understand and contextualize. Beverly, I really appreciate your time with us today.
Thank you.
This has been wonderful. And I just want to end with one thing. And just to say, I have found a poem, and I know I've mentioned this, that has just really moved me recently, especially because as we live through COVID and a very trying political time, in fact, there's a lot of waiting going on. And I found this wisdom is really speaking to me. Patience taught by nature. O dreary life, we cry, O dreary life. and still the generations of the birds sing through our sighing, and the flocks and herds serenely live while we are keeping strife with heaven's true purpose in us as a knife against which we may struggle. Ocean girds unslackened the dry land, savanna swards unweary sweep. Hills watch unworn, and rife meek leaves drop yearly from the forest trees to show above the unwasted stars that pass in their old glory. O thou God of old, grant me some smaller grace than comes to these, but so much patience as a blade of grass grows by contented through the heat and cold. Thank you, Elizabeth Barrett Browning, for giving me that perspective and giving all of us that perspective, and for your wonderful contributions to the world of literature and poetry. And Beverly Taylor, thank you for doing this.
Thank you. I enjoyed it. Thanks.
That's great. Thank you all for joining us. We are tonight, we'll be doing round two, or for those of us that are joining us for round two of Bart Ehrman's Heaven and Hell. Really wonderful talk. We want to remind people next Thursday, we have Dr. Christopher Browning returning virtually to our forums, online forums, to give a wonderful talk on revised thinking about ordinary men and the Holocaust, a very important topic. Of course, join us next Friday for the final Lunch with Friends and Strangers, where biologist Karen Fennig will be joining us to talk about Joseph Leidy, one of the great 19th century paleontologists. We're hitting all sorts of strangers here. Thank you again, Beverly. Thank you all for joining us. Thank you. Paul has put the link there for the Christopher Browning lecture. Thank you all of us for joining with us. Stay strong, and we'll see you next time.
Thanks.
Bye-bye now.
Bye.